Can diabetics eat sweet potatoes? Our nutritional experts claim it can prevent diabetes and help control blood sugars better. They even call it a superfood. Is there something special a sweet potato has over traditional white potatoes or any other starchy-based carbohydrate? What about the cooking methods? Does the time and temperature change the nature of foods like potatoes? And most importantly, how do we use today's information and incorporate it into a simple game plan for the best possible health markers and A1C? But before we begin, let me welcome all you resilient diabetics out there. This is the channel we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you're brand new and you don't know who I am, let me welcome you first and foremost. My name is Jay Sampat, and I am an insulin-dependent diabetic diagnosed a little over 6 years ago, so the proud owner of a pancreas that's gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I a diabetic just like you, where we walk in that walk and talk in that talk together, but I do also have a University of Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition dietetics, and that comes in very handy in discussing all the intricacies of being a diabetic. My goal is to put 4 years of chemistry, biochemistry, organic chemistry, and even human physiology into an easy 10-minute or so presentation so that you know how your diabetic body works better than, dare I say, your doctors? I sure did. The unique information presented today will only be found here on The Resilient Diabetic. New, life-changing episodes are released weekly. So if you want to learn more and you want to be notified by YouTube that a new video has been published, then the only way to do that is to hit that subscribe button first, followed by the gray notification bell. And then you have to choose turn on all notifications. And of course, if you liked and you enjoyed this video today, please hit that like button. What did that very top Google search produce when it came to sweet potatoes and diabetes? And I'll quote it. Unlike other starchy vegetables, sweet potatoes are considered to be an anti-diabetic food. What is an anti-diabetic food? I've never heard of that before. They continue with, yes, diabetics can eat sweet potatoes. The fiber helps with blood glucose control and weight management, and the potassium helps with blood pressure. So basically, we begin with the assessment that the micronutrients, the vitamins and minerals, are more important than the macronutrients, the carbohydrate content for our health as diabetics. The question is that true? So let me begin this important episode by exposing one of the biggest myths you have been sold on, how misinformation can become false truth and then reality. And what does this myth have to do with sweet potatoes? I'll make that very, very important connection for you soon. This is an example of how our institutional experts can twist facts to accomplish what's known as an agenda. It's a myth you've all come to believe, and I hate to break this news to you, and this is why you are watching The Resilient Diabetic and you are subscribed. You have been told that carrots are good for the eyes, right? Carrots do contain beta carotene. This substance is what gives carrots their orange color, but is also the precursor of the essential vitamin A. But here's the first problem. Studies have shown over and over again that vision benefits will only be seen if there's a deficiency in vitamin A. Eating more and more carrots will not improve eyesight. If carrots really worked, none of us diabetics would need glasses to begin with. Now, I bet it was your mom who was the one promoting carrots in the house to get you to eat your vegetables. Understandably so. But where did she get this from? Was she right? And what was the reasoning behind the myth? The myth carrots improve eyesight actually has its roots in World War II propaganda campaigns. During the 1940s Blitzkrieg, the Luftwaffe often struck during nightfall. In order to make it more difficult for the German planes to hit their targets, the British government then issued citywide blackouts. The Royal Air Force was able to repel the German fighter pilots in part because of a brand new development of a secret radar technology. This new top secret radar technology helped pilots shoot down German planes at night. But in order to keep this technology under wraps, the government said carrots were behind the pilot's success. Advertisements were then sent out during the war touting the benefits of carrots for nighttime vision. But there was a secondary reason for the push of carrots. Resources such as sugar, bacon, butter became very unavailable during the war. So the emphasis on self-sustainability in the home garden was really pushed. There were advertisements that were sent out to encourage families to start what's known as victory gardens and to try new recipes using surplus foods such as substitutes for those that were less available. Carrots were promoted as a sweetener in desserts in the absence of sugar. By 1942, England was looking at a 100,000-ton surplus of carrots. So the agenda to push carrots was in full swing. The British public generally believed that eating carrots would help them see better in citywide blackouts. But somewhere on that journey, the message that carrots were good for the eyes became morphed into the ability to improve eyesight. Carrots are a good source of vitamin A, which helps maintain eyesight. But carrots do not actually improve vision or help you see in the dark. This twisted truth has been stretched into this myth so that carrots get to hold this super vegetable title that we all get to continually spread. So what does vitamin A actually do for you? It supports cellular growth, plays a critical role in the normal function and maintenance of cells of the heart, the lungs, the kidneys, and other organs. Basically, vitamin A works as a powerful antioxidant. It fights against cell damage. When it comes to the eyes in particular, vitamin A helps the eyes convert light into a signal that can be transmitted to the brain, allowing people to see under conditions of low light. But once you've consumed enough beta carotene, your body will no longer convert vitamin A. The body naturally regulates against excessive amounts of vitamin A to prevent the accumulation of toxic levels of this fat-soluble substance. So, what is the connection between carrots and sweet potatoes, you may ask yourself? Both orange flesh sweet potatoes and carrots are known for being rich in beta carotene. But how do these two vegetables fare when they're matched up against each other? Which one is the ultimate beta carotene champion? Sweet potatoes, the ones with a darker orange flesh, contain up to 226 milligrams of beta carotene per 1 gram. Or 23 milligrams per 100 gram serving. By way in comparison, carrots provide 83 micrograms of beta carotene per 1 gram. Now we are strictly talking about the orange flesh sweet potatoes. White sweet potatoes are not good sources of beta carotene, which is not surprising considering that beta carotene is that plant pigment that gives vegetables and fruits that orange hue. But as diabetics, the single most important factor is our carbohydrate consumption and regulation, not necessarily the micronutrient aspects. 1 cup of carrots chopped will have around 12 grams of carbohydrates, whereas 1 cup of sweet potatoes will have around 27 grams. But here is the second big difference. Sweet potatoes are known as tubers. Tubers are enlarged roots or stems that the plants use to store their nutrients. And this is what makes them such dense sources of energy. In this case, they are what's known as starchy carbohydrates. And I have explained before, starches are simply molecules that consist of very large chains or numbers of glucose molecules all bonded together. So in essence, once consumed, the body immediately starts to break apart these bonds, releasing all that straight glucose or sugar straight into the bloodstream. The amounts of carbohydrates in sweet potatoes are so dense, I personally have a hard time consuming them, especially at night. For some reason, I will require more bolus insulin to cover me through the night, or I will wake up with incredibly high blood sugar readings in the morning. Now, here's where things get a little interesting. I do not get the same response when I eat white rice or potatoes. They do clear faster. Thus, with all things being equal, I require less insulin for those two starchy carbohydrates over sweet potatoes. But what about cooking methods? Does that really make a difference? Your body's not the only factor that starts to break down starches into straight sugar. Cooking does it too. So how does cooking affect sweet potatoes? The nutritional facts of raw and baked sweet potatoes can be vastly different. One cup of raw sweet potatoes may contain up to 114 calories, 27 grams of carbs, whereas one cup of baked sweet potatoes may contain up to 180 calories and 42 grams of carbs. That's a big difference. Why? How about a simple explanation? Heat breaks down the starch in the sweet potatoes in a way that allows your body to easily convert that starch into straight sugar, which then spikes your blood sugar levels a bit faster. So what does that specifically mean in the case of sweet potatoes? The longer sweet potatoes are exposed to heat, the faster and the easier the carbs will spike your blood sugars. Baking, for example, employs dry heat, which dehydrates the sweet potatoes, degrades the starches, and concentrates those sugars, and therefore increases the sugar content. Let's review everything to drive home two critical points. First, as a diabetic, the total carb intake is what is going to matter, more so than the cooking techniques. A recommended serving size is half a cup or half a medium-sized sweet potato for diabetics, because this is equivalent to 15 grams of carbohydrates. The question is, will that small amount keep you full and that way you're not hungry 2 hours later wanting more carbohydrates? I can answer that question for me. No, that's for sure. That is the first limitation of this starchy carbohydrate. Next, let's take a lateral step and also ask this really important question. How does sweet potatoes affect non-diabetics? Come to find out, it can be devastating too. I've seen those with perfect fasting blood sugar levels, typically around 85 to 95 milligrams a deciliter, fit and in shape, who after eating half a sweet potato, which is about 8 ounces, would move their blood sugars from the low hundreds to the high 100s within a matter of an hour. For most, it can easily move blood sugar 60, 70 points in 30 minutes. That is the exact same response a can of soda will give. Anti-diabetic food? Really? So if it affects non-diabetics who have healthy pancreases, who do not have resistant issues, then what do you think it's going to do to a type 2 diabetic? Sweet potatoes are considered a superfood for diabetics, says the American Diabetes Association. No, folks, I am not making this up. They even have sweet potato fry recipes on their website. Furthermore, the ADA recommends adults with diabetes consume around 45 to 60 grams of carbohydrates per meal, which adds up to about 135 to 180 grams of carbohydrates per day. And their justification of foods like sweet potatoes? They believe the substantial nutrient benefits offsets the impacts on blood sugars. Welcome to the dark ages, where they are still trying to argue the world is flat. What would happen to me personally if I followed their advice? Which also happens to fall in line with what I was taught in my nutrition dietetics program to treat diabetic patients. And for many of you, what your nutritional advisor may be suggesting. And I can easily break this down for you because I've tried the exact same thing when I was first diagnosed. And it was a complete and utter disaster. I would need twice to three times the amount of insulin. Patients with type 1 diabetes or type 1.5 LADAs with no pancreatic functioning like myself typically would require insulin doses to be around 0.4 to 1 unit per kilogram per day. For me, that would come out to around 32 to around 80 IU per day, and that was what I needed, but up in the middle upper range of that scale. And I was doing everything right because my blood sugars were regulated. The higher insulin requirements kept me controlled and reflected a great A1C, but that was half the picture. The higher carb intake, thus insulin requirements, brought on an ever-sickening body, even though I was eating very healthy foods like sweet potatoes. My cholesterol levels went through the roof. My HDL levels dropped. My triglycerides went up. My blood pressure surged. I was packing on body fat. And add insult to injury, I was put on the dreaded statins. I did a quick about face. This madness had to stop. I immediately realized that the lower my insulin requirements, the better my health. The first thing I did was severely limit all starchy carbs and consume small amounts of fruits to only the days I trained with weights. The starchy carbs were replaced with outsized, large portions of cruciferous above ground vegetables. That change dropped my insulin requirements to around 17 to 22 IU per day. That is half of what is needed at the bottom end of that recommended scale. So what happened next? My cholesterol levels dropped. My HDL went straight back up. My triglycerides dropped. My blood pressure dropped. Guess what happened to my weight? That dropped. Body fat came flying off. And the best part, sensitivity started to skyrocket again. This exact low-carb diet allows me to look just like this. I have the energy levels to train 6 days a week, and intensely, I might add, while also still having to work 7 days a week. And I feel great all day long. This is what I call the resilient diet, or the anti-inflammatory diet. Humility is one virtue of being a resilient diabetic. I can speak for myself here, but having an open mind to be willing to continually learn is the cornerstone to success. As the facts change, so do I. But as I can see, many diabetics are marginalized, they're confused, they're torn in two different directions. Is that sweet potato really a superfood or an anti-diabetic food? As diabetics, it is the carbohydrate load on the body that will be your main concern. Getting a good source of key micronutrients, such as beta carotene, is a close second. You always want enough to supply the body, but then always opt for the lower carbohydrate, nutrient-dense, cruciferous vegetable sources, which means less body inflammation. So yes, contrary to the propaganda push on carrots, they actually win in my house over sweet potatoes. Carrots provide all the necessary micronutrients, the vitamins, the minerals, but are lower in carbohydrates. So they are a staple of my diet for dinner, along with above-ground cruciferous vegetables and a lean source of protein. I'll create an important link, a playlist for you with more videos related to blood sugar control. In the episode, what to do when blood sugars are high, that's an important one. How do you go about bringing down blood sugars after that unexpected or expected high? Does drinking water help? If you're a new diabetic, do you know the limitations of the single most important tool you have as a diabetic, your glucose meter? In the episode, Diabetic Glucose Meter Mistakes, I will cover the unknowns and the knowns every diabetic must master. If you're on a desktop or laptop, use your mouse to click that box. If you're a mobile device, tap that with your fingers. So, have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which I've said are always released weekly. Bye for now.